A fresh batch of astronauts, called the New Nine, were chosen to help America get to the moon. Some of these names may sound familiar. Neil Armstrong, John Young, Jim Lovell, Pete Conrad, and Ed White. With a brand new spacecraft, Project Gemini would be the bridge between Mercury and Apollo. Mercury proved man can survive in space, but Gemini would test if a man can work in space, if tasks like rendezvous, docking, extravehicular activity, or staying in space for long periods of time couldn't be done, the United States could forget landing on the moon. After the first manned Gemini flight with Gemini 3, the next big task would be EVA. The Russians again achieved that first with cosmonaut Alexei Leonov, but America got its first successful spacewalk with Ed White on Gemini 4 in 1965.
Separate from the spacecraft.
Okay, separate from the spacecraft.
There's
a tremendous
picture
of you. Let me try
to give us a hot ball. Okay, I think I've exhausted my air now.
Stay right there.
Gemini 6 and 7 tackled rendezvous and long-duration spaceflight. Astronauts Frank Borman and Jim Lovell orbited the Earth for 2 weeks inside a Gemini spacecraft. Imagine being cramped inside a phone booth for 2 weeks with one other person. It was about like that. Gemini faced some problems with a few of its later missions. After connecting with an Agena docking target, a stuck thruster caused Gemini 8 to spin out of control, and the mission was cut short.
Yes, sir. I'm docked.
Neil Armstrong and Dave Scott made it out okay, though. The next three flights all experienced another challenge, working in space. Even though Ed White on Gemini 4 successfully walked in space, he did not do much outside of float around. Astronauts in Gemini's 9, 10, and 11 were exhausting themselves trying to work in space due to Isaac Newton's third law of motion. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Astronaut Gene Cernan recalled on his Gemini 9 flight that instead of turning, say, a valve, unless he was held in place by something, he would turn instead and start floating away. This problem stalled progress until astronaut Buzz Aldrin found a solution by taking a completely new approach to spacewalks. He figured out that one can simulate the conditions of working in space using a swimming pool. After modifying the Gemini spacecraft with special handles, footholds, and strapping, Buzz Aldrin made working in space look easy. And he knew it too. All of Gemini's objectives had been accomplished, and the stage was set for Apollo. In 1967, America was feeling go fever, which means there was an overall mindset to rush and get things done while overlooking potential problems or errors. America would feel the consequences of go fever with the tragic loss of the Apollo 1 crew. Mercury veteran Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee. A fire broke out during a routine plugs out test on the launch pad, claiming the lives of the astronauts. It was concluded that the cause of the fire was due to frayed wiring serving as an ignition source, combined with a 100% pure oxygen environment. The astronauts died not by burns, but by asphyxiation from toxic smoke. On the other side, the Soviets had stumbled around the same time as well, with the loss of cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov, when the parachute on his Soyuz spacecraft failed to properly deploy, and he crashed. Apollo's rocky start serves as a reminder that the space business is a hazardous one, leaving no room for error. Apollo had to put on the brakes, and after a complete overhaul of the command module's design and several successful unmanned test flights, Apollo 7 got America back into the race in October 1968. 1968 was a rough year for the United States, for not only were both Robert Kennedy and Martin Luther King Jr. assassinated that year, but 1968 also saw the height of the Vietnam War with the Tet Offensive. To add insult to injury, there were rumors that the Soviets had planned to send a spacecraft around the moon by the end of that year. With the brand new launch vehicle called the Saturn V, the largest and most powerful rocket ever built to date, it was time for a morale boost, and America got one with Apollo 8 in December. Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders circumnavigated the moon, and came back safely. The mission resulted in one of the most iconic photographs ever taken, called Earthrise. It was one of those cultural phenomenons which made the entire world stop what it was doing and look with awe. The end of the decade was fast approaching, and it was time to fulfill President Kennedy's vision. A new vehicle had been specially designed for landing on the moon, called the Lunar Module. After several successful lunar module tests with Apollos 9 and 10, the United States would get its shot at the moon in July of 1969. Four days after launch, on July 20th, the Eagle had landed.
Contact light. Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Neil Armstrong stepped off the lunar module, and upon planting his foot in the lunar soil, this signified America's victory in the space race. The United States had won.
That's one small step for man.
Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin then planted Old Glory on the moon, where that very flag remains to this day. Unfortunately, after Apollo 11, public sentiment quickly faded. Even though the missions after Apollo 11 became more science-heavy and focused on unlocking the mysteries of the moon, a public disinterest towards moon missions and spaceflight in general set in. Budget cuts started creeping in, and the moon missions ended after Apollo 17, despite their major scientific breakthroughs. It is worth noting that a temporary spike in interest came when Apollo 13 suffered an accident on the way to the moon, and, when the lives of the astronauts were in jeopardy, everyone came together once more to help the Apollo 13 crew make it back home. The space program needed a new purpose, and there was a shift towards much less ambitious goals, like space stations. But there was a silver lining in this shift. The Apollo-Soyuz test project in 1975 was significant because it represented a warming of sorts during the Cold War. For the first time ever, this would be an international flight, where Americans and Soviets met in space and shook hands. This ease and tension between the Americans and Soviets would mark the beginning of international efforts in space, where countries would work together to achieve goals. One can only wonder, where to next?